I'm going to introduce you to a technique that I call reverse engineering a photo. I use this technique and I teach it because it's like the fast way and the easy way to make your own photos get better. And it's by deconstructing someone else's photo that is really working. So the most common problem that I see in the photos that people present and that they are taking with their compositions is that they are too busy. They're including too many things inside the photo and it creates compositions that are cluttered. So let's take a look at Annette Unheim's photos and deconstruct them and reverse engineer them. And what's so interesting about her photos, it's the background. Sometimes you need to look intentionally at the background even more than the main subject to figure out why the photo looks so good. Look at her backgrounds. They are all untextured. They are uncluttered. They're clean. And we just have that one thing in the composition. And of course, our goal is to create art that's pleasing to the eye. And we do that by creating a composition with one thing. So notice the theme that your genre of photography needs to be one thing. And then when you're actually lifting your camera to your eye and you're selecting a composition, it also needs to be one thing. Wendy Klein, she uses that skill of finding one thing in her compositions and she specializes in sunsets. Look at this one. She just took it yesterday. She just posted this in our Facebook group. Like, wow. Like she took something that normally could be considered ugly and she made it beautiful. Right. Chris Collicott, we took a good look at his work and he specialized in one thing, which was first the compositions. He would find one big main subject. And then he specialized in one genre, one specialty within photography. I think about a band, like one of my favorite bands, the Eagles. You don't hear the Eagles playing electronic music, jazz, heavy metal. The Eagles play one genre of music, which is country rock, and they stick to it. And because they stick with it, they get so good at it and they are the best. And it's really the same thing because music is an art form. And it's the same thing with photography, which is also an art form, one thing. And so we looked at the work of David Hemmings and how he turned a passion of being outdoors into a full-time career and specialized in that one thing and got incredibly good at it. We're going to look at the work of Hobby Sans and he creates that one dreamy look, dramatic, moody, Lord of the Rings type stuff. And he has become very, very good at it. So I am asking you to consider what your own style and voice is that you want in your photography. And the answer to this question starts with first determining what do you want from your photography? And then from there, you specialize in what genre you want to get good at, what genre you want to master, or what technique. It may just be one specific technique. Like Wendy Klein, she uses long exposure photography to take like 30-second or 60-second long pictures so that the movement in the clouds becomes streaked. And that is like the trademark look of a Wendy Klein photo. She got good at that technique. I use Lightroom for my photo editing. Some photographers use Photoshop, but I've already explained that Photoshop was not made for photographers. It was made for graphic designers. And I find that Lightroom is incredibly easy to use. And I have a question for you. As you look at this picture of this bear, would you like to see how I edited this bear photo, how I edited this in just 5 steps? Let's take a look at my Lightroom screen. I'm going to show you now how fun it can actually be to retouch a photo using the same principles of an actual artist who uses a paintbrush. I love doing this. And the important thing is to have an objective right from the start, not to just be randomly trying different things, but to actually know what you want. And this is where having your own voice through your photography is so important. So with my personal voice, I want to choose compositions that have just one thing and have one powerful hero. So let's analyze this photo first before we even touch it. And what I see going for the photo is that clearly there's a main subject, but there's something competing for attention in the photo. And that's this background. It's an ugly background. It's busy. It's cluttered. So I want to reduce it. So the first thing I'm going to do is to do a crop, which just means cropping out all of the external stuff that we don't need so that all we're left with is the one thing in the photo. And this is a pretty heavy crop, but because the photo that I took is tack sharp, the photo can withstand that much crop and it still looks very good. So first thing I'm going to do is just warm up the photo a little bit. I turned up the temperature just a little bit. And now I want to do something about this background. So I'm looking at this, I'm kind of stepping back and I'm saying, wow, that green in the background is really competing for the attention of the viewer and it's drawing my eye to it. So I want to reduce the green of that background. It's so easy to do. There's a saturation slider. This is called saturation, and the individual colors can be selected. So this is a green slider, green saturation, and watch this. I can turn up the green if I want, and I can also reduce it. So I'm going to reduce it, and I've reduced the amount of green there. Let's just look at how it was. There's zero reduction, and now I've backed it right down. I don't want to do too much. I don't want it to look black and white. In addition, I think there are a lot of yellow tones back there that I don't want. So let's pull back on the yellow tones and further reduce the amount of glare that's in that background. And there's one more thing I want to do. I'm looking at the fur of the grizzly bear and I'm seeing orange tones. Let's turn up the orange tones so that our main subject really has some color. In fact, our main subject has more color than the background. This is a type of contrast. And already, just by moving three little sliders, I have already enhanced this image in a very big way. But there are two more things I'm going to do to the image. Only two, and then we'll call it done. The first one is, again, this background. It's bothering me because it's so bright and my eye is attracted to it. So there's a slider here called exposure. If I turn up the exposure, it's like turning the lights on the entire image. And the same thing, if I turn it down, it makes the whole image dark. So I'm only looking at the background now, okay? I'm not looking at the bear. My eyes are looking at the background. How far can I turn this down and still have it possibly look natural? And I can turn it down to there, and the background can still look natural. So what's the last thing that I need to do? I need to shine a spotlight on the hero of this story, which is the bear. And to do that, I'm going to choose a circle tool and I'm going to shine a spotlight exactly on our main subject here. So here we go. And I'm going to turn up the light on it to, let's just say, about there. Let's reshape our circle and pull it down just a little bit and pull this down. I'll pull in this side, pull in that side. I want it to look natural and I want there to be a very clear hero to the story of this photo. Let's click done and see if we like it. I like it. It's moody. It's dramatic. This is an amazing bear. There's just one last thing that kind of bothers me. These weeds over here are a little too bright, so let's grab our artist's paintbrush. Now this is literally like an artist's paintbrush. I can make it large, I can make it small, and so let's paint in a little bit of darkness over top of these bright weeds here and over top of these rocks. And over on the right side, while we're at it, let's just paint in some darkness there too. And all I need to do is now turn down the highlights over top of what I just painted and turn down the white slider, and now we have an image. Let's look at the before and after. This is always the fun part. So here is our before and after. So on the left, yeah, nice photo, but it's not like, wow, that's a real beauty. And over on the right, I see drama. I see a moodiness to it. I see a beautiful photo that truly captures my attention because the one thing in this photo, the one main subject, is popping off the background. So let's look at the true before. I'll reset the photo right to our starting point, and then I'll put it back to where our edits are. And there we have it. I moved literally five things inside Lightroom. It's so easy to do. And this is the process where you find your own voice. You create your own voice through your photography, and you pick a genre and you pick a style of photo that you like, and then you create your own photos that look exactly like that. So I noticed in my screen share in the live feed that it was actually darker than what was actually on my screen. So here it is, just a little bit brighter. And again, intentionally, I'm making this a darker photo. I'm making it a moodier photo. So I want to know, what did you think of that? Like, was that a really cool transformation to go from that really big, wide scope where you saw a whole bunch of stuff in the photo? It was a big composition, kind of noisy. And now we've just honed in on that one thing. Is that, what do you think of it? Do you like it? So for me, it's all about those brush strokes, using a brush just like a painter uses a brush. And that's what I actually find fun. It really brings out the artistic side in me, and I absolutely love it.